Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tony Fisher, and welcome to this, the latest in our line of short webinars, focusing on legal subjects which have come into sharp focus during the course of the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm here this morning with Rebecca Palmer, a specialist construction solicitor, who's going to talk about the key factors that you need to keep in mind to protect your construction business, both now during the pandemic and going forward. If you look in the top right-hand corner of your screen, you'll see that there is a handout button which you can download the slides from. There's also a Q&A tab, and if you'd like to ask any questions, then please feel free to do that, and Rebecca will come back to you offline after the seminar is over. It's also being recorded and will be available, as are all the other webinars in this series, on our website. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Rebecca Palmer.
Many thanks, Tony. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. As Tony mentioned, I'm a specialist in construction law. So this means my clients are typically employers or contractors, subcontractors or consultants, and I advise on all aspects of their construction projects. So moving on to our first slide, the agenda. So first of all, what we will not be covering today, so I'm not going to be looking in any great depth at health and safety or insurance. But so on the health and safety front, of course, we're assuming that every site will have been reviewing their ways of working to ensure compliance with the Health and Safety at Work Act 1974, because of course there's a duty on employers to ensure, so far as reasonably practicable, the health, safety and welfare at work of their employees. And of course, we'll be mindful of the Management of Health and Safety Act work regulations, because there's the requirement in those regulations for there to be risk assessments reviewed in light of current circumstances. The other aspect I won't be looking at in any great detail is the insurance. Of course, we are expecting that we will all be notifying our insurers and keeping them up to date on the day-to-day circumstances of our projects. So what I will be covering over the next few minutes are points relating specifically to the legal themes that we need to continue to keep in mind at this time, and some practical points that we need to be mindful of when checking through our contracts now and also for the foreseeable future. Just a few points that I've drawn together as being likely to need further consideration in light of the impact on construction of COVID-19. When I was putting together this webinar, the conclusions that I drew, having put together the content, the conclusions were very much echoing those themes that I find myself saying to my clients and contacts in all circumstances. Ultimately, it all boils down to the importance of us all really knowing our contracts and keeping very thorough records throughout our projects so that we're able to back up the assertions that we make as regards our legal position. This is the case whether we're an employer, a contractor, a subcontractor, or any other advisor to any of those parties. Okay, so moving on to the important relevant legal themes, and here they are. So the first one, of course, is going to be force majeure. There's no established meaning of force majeure in English law. And so this means that it's going to be the wording of each individual clause that dictates the meaning and our position. The case law does show us that force majeure clauses tend to be interpreted literally. And without a force majeure clause in your contract, you're not going to be able to use the argument. Typically, these clauses will provide that where an event has occurred which is beyond the control of the party relying on the clause, that party's obligations to perform the contract are going to be temporarily suspended. So in that way, the clause is seeking to excuse what would probably otherwise be a breach. The other aspect that the force majeure clauses typically will cover, they'll say that the party wishing to benefit from the clause needs to serve a valid notice on the other party or parties. So this description that I've given, this does not mean that the contract necessarily has to use the actual words force majeure. But what we are looking for is wording such as any other clause beyond the contractor's reasonable control, or maybe it might use the words act of God. Whether or not the clause is going to generate an entitlement to money will depend on its drafting. So in an unamended JCT context, the force majeure clause provides for extra time because it's a defined relevant event. However, force majeure does not invoke a right to loss and expense because it isn't a defined relevant matter in a JCT context. In an NEC context, it's a bit different. And the force majeure clause provides for both time and money because force majeure constitutes what in NEC speak we refer to as a compensation event. Back to JCT though, force majeure is undefined in the JCT suite and there are no reported cases that we can use to clarify its meaning. It's only going to be able to be relied upon though by a party who has taken reasonable steps to mitigate or overcome the event. And under an unamended JCT, of course, we need to remember that there's also that obligation on the contractor requiring them to use best endeavours to prevent delay. So whether or not a force majeure event has occurred is going to turn on the wording of the particular clause and the impact of COVID-19 on the site of the project to which the contract relates. Given the significance, though, of the impact of this global pandemic, we can assume that most force majeure clauses will view COVID-19 as a force majeure event. So it really is a very important component of the legal themes you need to be keeping in mind. So that's force majeure, the first one. But we also need to be mindful of this second bullet, which is the other grounds on which additional time or money may be sought. If we're the employer, we need to be mindful of the fact that these grounds may well be cited to us and to our team. And if we're the contractor, we obviously need to be mindful of the importance of us invoking our rights to seek time and money on these other grounds. So what do I mean by these other grounds? Many construction contracts contain other clauses as well as the force majeure clause, which give rise to time and or money. I would be looking in particular at the clauses that relate to changes in the law, also clauses that relate to the exercise of statutory powers by local and central government. We also need to be making sure we're familiar with the clauses that deal with employer impediments. For example, are instructions regarding how to deal with the impact of COVID-19 being delayed? That may well be deemed to be an employer impediment, thereby entitling a contractor to potentially time and potentially money or loss and expense under JCT. So we've said changes in the law, exercise of statutory power, employers' impediments. Also, what about delays by the statutory undertakers? This is another old chestnut that we need to make sure we cite if we need to be invoking another ground for seeking certainly time. And what about compliance with instructions or directions? For example, in the particular current context, what about instructions and directions regarding the shutting down or the reopening of the site? Another clause that we need to be checking. And then, of course, postponement of the works. How does our contract provide for works to be postponed? Is there a particular period of time for which postponement has no impact? And then after that time, there is a greater impact in terms of time and money. That's another point that we need to check. So we've got force majeure, other grounds for which the contract provides we may be seeing an entitlement to time and money. Then what about frustration, the third issue? So frustration is totally different from force majeure. Frustration is a common law remedy, but unfortunately it's rarely used successfully. So it's a very difficult one to establish. You may well not be pursuing it. It's just one to keep in mind at the back of your mind. Attempts to establish frustration often do fail. But unlike force majeure, it brings the contract to an end. So you remember I was saying that force majeure suspends performance. Frustration is different. It brings the contract to an end, and therefore it's a risky approach because, of course, if your attempts to cite frustration arguments fail, then the bringing of the contract to the end could be a repudiatory breach. It's also, in frustration, difficult to recover the innocent party's costs. So the frustration, the way it operates, is it renders the contract impossible to perform or it transforms those contractual obligations into something that are radically different. Again, unlikely that you're going to be using it, but one to be borne in mind in case it can be applied and in case all your other arguments fail. Okay, so two other important legal themes to keep in mind. Notices. These are always going to be required under your contract to make sure that you invoke the available protection protection available to you. So if you're a contractor or a subcontractor, you need to be certainly serving notices and the backup documentation that is required. I often come across in commercial settings a reluctance to serve notices due to a perceived aggression of serving them. And this is not the case. This is where we need to kind of change how we run our construction projects. We need to see notices purely as informative. It's a relaying of communication between the parties to make sure you're keeping each other up to date on where you're at. They don't need to be aggressive, simply informative. But the timing and the method and the format of a notice is really very important. And it's the contract that's going to set out what the timing, the method and the format need to be. In particular, we need to be making sure if the contract provides for the timing of the notice and if there is a condition precedent. Is the notice a condition precedent to any entitlement to time or money? If it is, then obviously it's absolutely critical that those notices are served in time if we are seeking to obtain time and money. Generally, as a rule of thumb, it's best to give notices as soon as possible. Certainly under JCT, notices that require an extension of time generally need to be issued when the progress of the works is being or is likely to be delayed. As I said, note the contract's deadline for the notices, and particularly if any standard forms have been amended, check whether or not the deadlines have been amended also. Also be mindful of the general boilerplate notices provision and the impact that that general provision, often at the very beginning or the very end of the contract, the impact of that provision on the specific notices that you're serving. Okay, and then the last important legal theme is, of course, as I mentioned at the beginning, the importance of record keeping and the keeping of evidence. The burden of proof when bringing a claim is going to be on the party seeking to rely on, say, the force majeure clause that they've got in their contract. And the record keeping that you and your team have done will always be key to establishing your position. So in this particular pandemic context, what sort of record keeping are we referring to? It's going to be those records of perhaps staff being unable to attend. So that would be evidence by way of perhaps doctor's certificates or perhaps witness statements. What about evidence of site closures and site reopening? Do we have contemporaneous confirmations of deliveries being late, for example? Do we have evidence of the efforts or lack of them for seeking alternative staff in place of those who were unavailable? What about correspondence within between the parties pointing out the dangers and risks that are on site and that need to be altered, and perhaps requesting alterations to working practices, and then evidence of those working practices on site? And then, of course, the programming evidence becomes critical, because we will need to be demonstrating, if we're using force majeure as an argument, that it was the sole cause of the delay, and are we able to do that? This is where programming evidence can really assist us. So lots of examples of potential evidence that need to be kept. For example, a contractor's exercise of its duty to use best endeavours to mitigate delay is a really important qualification to its right to an extension of time. So from a contractor's perspective, they would need to be able to produce all their email correspondence and the notes of their calls demonstrating that they continued off-site activities to the extent that they were able to safely, to the extent that they reprogrammed the works in line with version 3 of the Construction Leadership Council's site operating procedures. That's now the prevalent industry-wide standard. Perhaps we would need to see some correspondence exploring sources of labour replacement. It's looking as though it's going to be that site operating procedure document that the HSE will be relying on when deciding if a site is operating safely or not during these times, and whether or not enforcement action is warranted. So it's likely to be your bible at present if you're on the contractor side. I recommend the production of a daily narrative, setting out who's doing what, when, where, why, to attempt to keep track of these very fluid times. And then, of course, I should mention costs. Which costs are attributable to which cause? It's really very important that the records that you keep are separate for each type of costs. All need to be, all the costs need to be recorded separately, whether they're attributable, say, to stopping on site, slowing down on site, demobilising, remobilising, making the site safe, material cost and the like. So keep all those costs separate. If you follow these guidance, this guidance, then you're going to be in a position, should you need to defend or assert your position, you're going to be able to present your legal advisors with as a set of documentation that really means they will be able to put your point forward or defend your position, as the case may be, in the best possible way. Right, so now that we've been through those key legal themes, the second and final part of the webinar is just to have a little look through the points that I've drawn together from lots of commentary that's around at the moment on COVID-19's impact. And it's drawing together points that we need as people working within the construction industry, points that we need to make sure we're checking in our contracts generally. Contracts that are current and contracts certainly that we are going to sign up to and negotiate going forwards. So I'm seeing lots of changes, and one of them is where the parties are seeking to negotiate whether or not coronavirus and or COVID-19's impact is going to be a relevant event or a relevant matter or a compensation event. So by way of example, I've had an example this week of the parties seeking to draw a line in the sand to explain that the contractor is absorbing the impact of COVID-19 up until a particular date, namely the date of the contract, and then the impact of COVID-19 thereafter would be a circumstance for which they would be entitled to additional time. That's a shift in the time scale from the standard JCT position. It's a JCT contract on which this the project is based, but with a schedule of amendments. So we can see a likely avenue of amendments whereby the impact of COVID is going to be more articulated in terms of extra time and money. Of course, employers will resist those specific new relevant matters and relevant events being cited. But a middle ground is going to be able to be found. And this is where we need to be very careful about how the term foreseeable is used. So have amendments to standard forms been rechecked for their acceptability? Because often we do have references to foreseeability, and what is foreseeable now, such as site shutdown due to a second wave of the virus, is going to be quite different from what perhaps was foreseeable a few months ago. And so I would caution you to recheck schedules of amendments to ensure that they continue to be serving your needs at this point in time as they did previously. Back to other key points to look out for. How have the tender qualifications been handled? Depending on whether we're the contractor or the employer, we need to make sure that they have been dealt with appropriately. Have they been, if we're a contractor, have our qualifications on what we've priced for been addressed expressly in the wording? Are the component documents of the contract internally consistent? So this is a really important one. It's not specific to the pandemic. We have a lot of issues, don't we, in construction contracts where the legal terms and conditions and the technical documentation, all these different terms of the contract, they are all spread out across different documents. Those documents need to mesh together so that they are internally consistent to the extent that there are inconsistencies, there are vulnerabilities to future arguments. So we need to be definitely checking that. I've already mentioned whether whether or not the standard forms amendments have been rechecked. So that one's on the list for sure. What about social distancing and changing working practices in particular? So now that we have had a bit of time of getting used to these, maybe we're of a view that we can begin to estimate their impact, or at least in part. So what extent, taking social distancing as an example, what extent of social distancing, for example, can our contractor absorb, and what extent can he not absorb and will therefore incur implications in terms of time and perhaps money? So we need to have made sure that the contract expressly deals with that. We need to be clear in our heads which scenario, which extent of, say, social distancing has been priced. And then we need to also be clear in our heads, is there going to be the best case scenario that's been priced? And then we share with our contractual counterparty a shared prelim saving. Or are we going to go for pricing of a worst case scenario, and then we would be sharing a prelims overspend? Okay, what about occupation? What level of occupation is assumed, and how will changes in noise and access to the project be dealt with in the contract? And then payment, obviously an important provision always, but in particular now, do we need to amend the payment regime do in order to preserve the cash flow, to oil those wheels to make sure we don't lose our whole supply chain if we're the employer? Is provision going to be made now for an advance payment that would not otherwise have been provided? On the materials front, to what extent are we going to permit substitution of materials? We need to consider if there are specific vulnerabilities in our supply chain. Are there niche bespoke products, or perhaps products that are being procured from outside of the UK? Do those vulnerabilities dictate that we need to tweak the contract to permit further substitution, perhaps with certain control measures in place as well? When we're talking about materials, of course, we need to also consider whether we need to be including for provision of deposit payments, vesting certificates, and perhaps what about enhanced site security, given some of the increased risks of theft at the moment. Okay, so that is materials. I mentioned earlier possession. This is something that we need to be checking. So when will possession be given? And what conditions will have been achieved first, so that we can assure ourselves that once possession is given, the works can progress efficiently? What extent of deferral might be permitted? What, will it be absorbed by a contractor or not? Is there perhaps some sort of a long stop date in place, so that a certain amount of deferred possession is absorbed, but not beyond that long stop? How will time and money be impacted in those circumstances? Another niche point, working hours. So the local planning authorities have relaxed these, but of course we need to have be mindful of the wording in our prelims, because if there are restrictions that are tighter than those relaxed working hours, if the prelims have got those restrictions, then the relaxation of the LPA's working hours is going to have a limited impact if nevertheless we need to stick to more restrictive hours in the prelims themselves. And then of course suspension. What happens if suspension is prolonged? For example, if there, God forbid, is a second wave, can either party terminate, and how would such termination be treated? Whose fault would it be, or would it be a no-fault event? These are all the key points that we need to be clear our contract addresses and in agreement with how the contract will tackle these circumstances should they arise. Okay, so I hope that has been helpful in just drawing some key issues together. So we're now turning to the final slide, where I've just got a couple of closing comments really. The punchlines are very much, as I said at the beginning, the same as we often find ourselves saying to our clients and contacts. Knowing your contract, there is no replacement for that. English law allows you as a commercial party to allocate the risks of the project between you and your counterparties as you wish. But it also assumes that you have understood what you have signed, and that's where we as solicitors can really assist you. Every word counts, and it is as imperative now as it has ever been that the wording to which you commit yourselves and you sign matches your understanding of the deal that you have struck. Another key point, keep your records. These, coupled with knowing your contract, allows you to really understand your legal position and to be able to demonstrate it if you need to. That doesn't necessarily mean I'm saying you're going to be able to fight the fight should the fight arrive. I'm just explaining that in your notices and your toing and froing of correspondence amongst the parties, you want to be able to clearly explain why you think as you do and why your position is as it is. For current projects, the Construction Leadership Council's best practice guidance really encourages parties to meet and discuss openly the commercial issues arising. So this is akin to what we lawyers term without prejudice, subject to contract discussions. So whilst there tends to be a general reluctance in the industry to get into the nitty-gritty of discussing time and money, perhaps these pandemic circumstances are going to shift that a little. It is always best to engage with your contractual counterparties early to agree a way forward, particularly in such unprecedented times. And if you're clear on your position, then we are able to help you do this in a way that need not be aggressive and is simply part of the humdrum of running your contracts efficiently. Whatever your project role, whether you're an employer, contractor, subcontractor, consultant, by knowing your contract and keeping your detailed records, you will be able to put forward your position with confidence and thereby get the best project outcomes from your collaborative discussions with your contract counterparties. So I do hope that you have found this useful. As Tony mentioned, we're here to assist. Do call if there's any queries we can help you with. And trust you keep well in these difficult times. All the very best from me. Goodbye.
And thank you very much, Rebecca, for that. And I hope everybody has found that very useful. Very many complex issues arising as a result of COVID-19 in the construction industry. And the advice which we're all giving everybody at the moment is that be pragmatic, be commercial, try and negotiate your way out of situations rather than trying to rely on remedies which may take considerable periods of time now to be pursued. And if you'd like to receive any further advice from Rebecca, you can contact her by email as rweber@fjg.co.uk or look at our website and you'll see her profile there, and you'll be able to contact her through the website. Okay, well, thank you very much, everybody, for joining us today, and I hope you have a good rest of the day, and we will see you at the next webinar.